Thank you, Ivan. Good morning, everyone. So I'm Pierre Gayle, and I will present this work about rapid response to earthquake and how to go from the estimation of the earthquake to the associated damage and losses. And so most of the work also has been done with the help of many partners, so I will also mention their contributions. So first of all, this is a quick overview of the problem. So starting from the earthquake event here, we want to estimate first in a rapid context the maps of ground motion parameters of seismic intensity, and from there to get maps of damage rates of buildings, associated loss, and so on, or even accessibility of road networks, for instance. And with this, the first step is the ground motion estimation. So this will be done by computing what is called a shape maps. So that relies on, let's say, predictive models of ground motion prediction equations, maps of site amplification factors in the area, but also a whole set of sensors and observations from the ground that we will discuss later. And as well here, for the risk and the damage assessment, we use predictive models like exposure data for the area, associated fragility models, infrastructure loss models, and also real-time observations that can be gathered from sensors or citizen data if you want. And then we can finally get to aggregation of the situation, which is called the rapid loss updating. So the whole thing, first I will develop the shake map estimation algorithms, then the exposure and vulnerability modeling, and then discuss also alternative sources of observations that were studied and investigated in this project. So the monitoring of structures, and also the use of citizen observations, and then the rapid damage and loss assessment, and finally, let's say, more innovative approaches related to the updating of loss and damage using a Bayesian theory at the level of a structure and also at the level of a whole area, for instance. So first, shake maps. So general principle is that once we have knowledge of the magnitude, location, or even sometimes focal mechanism of the earthquake event, using a predictive model like a ground motion prediction equations, we can, estimate the distribution of a ground motion parameter, like a peak ground acceleration at some locations, for instance, X1 and X2 of the map of the area. And then if we have observations, these are called M1 and M2 here, the green triangles, we can use these observations to constrain the ground motion field in the area and then compute the on a whole set of a grid points, the whole map of, and this is done by, like I said, using station recordings, but also sometimes felt reports that are like macro seismic testimonies of people that live in the area. And this is done by usually using mostly the ground motion prediction equation. So here is the median estimate of your ground motion prediction equation. And the algorithm works by playing around with the inter-event and intra-event error that is related to the equation and that is updated by the observations. So to do this, we have applied a Bayesian networks here to update the intensity on the grid. So it works like this. So you have your observations, M1 and M2. They are entered as evidence in the network. And then you have a global correction, that is the correction of the inter-event error. And then you have also a local correction, that is the correction from the intra-event error. And this, in the end, it will update the ground motion estimates on all the grid points of your map. So I will spare you all the mathematics that is associated, but yeah. And And this is an example, for instance, of a shake map that was generated using this method from an earthquake that happened in the Pyrenees in France, near the city of Lourdes in 2012. It was a magnitude 4.3. And this is the mean PGA map on the left. You have the contours in a percentage of G. And you see the triangles where, let's say, seismic stations in free field that recorded the ground motion. And the small circles in green here are micro seismic observations. And on the right is the related uncertainty of the ground motion field. And you see that it is constrained with a lower uncertainty close to the observations. Now we're moving on to exposure and vulnerability modeling. So this work has been done with Bauhaus University of Weimar. So they designed a knowledge-based exposure modeling framework that allows to, let's say, use different types of a classification scheme for exposure and vulnerability, like the EMS 98 vulnerability classes, or also the global earthquake modeling GEM or SERA codifications. And from this, you can get different levels of, let's say, variability or uncertainty on a related fragility models. And then you can apply this whole setup to different distributions on your actual buildings in an exposed area. So this is an example of the application of this knowledge-based exposure modeling framework in the various test beds. So you have two options. You can, for instance, when you have a taxonomy distribution in your test bed area, in your study area, you can just select a set of fragility curves from the literature. And so you select your curves, and then you can apply them right away. Or also, you can, let's say, use the SERA taxonomy that is available in each testbed area. And you can associate it with structural types of vulnerability classes that are present in the EMS 98 scale. And using a weighting system, then you can come up with an associated vulnerability index for these different taxonomies. So for instance, this is an example of this second options. When you start from a SERA taxonomy, you have a given structural type, like a reinforced concrete buildings with walls as lateral load resisting system and non-seismically designed. And you apply a corresponding vulnerability class with some distributions also. And then you can apply the relevant weighting to then design your vulnerability index from this. What has also been done is a development or enhancement of new fragility models for various cases in the testbed areas. So this work has also been done with the help of a new center in Italy. And see here, for instance, here is an example of a selection of relevant fragility models for residential buildings and service buildings in the testbed of Iceland. And also, so using the EU Center tool, some fragility curves for bridges were selected based on a set of structural features. Some bridges, this is an example of a Mark bridge in the Pyrenees mountain range in France. Here an example of a Gorder bridges in the Groningen province in the Netherlands. From a selection of various structural features, you can propose a fragility model that provides a probability of damage given seismic intensity. And some specific developments have also been done, especially for the Porto Vojautaro in Italy, where some numerical modeling has been carried out for a set of wharf and crane system in the port of Jarotaro. So this is the led to development of analytical fragility curves. And also now, so we spoke a lot here about single assets like buildings or bridges. And also, there is another part of the project that concentrated on infrastructure systems. So like road networks, or power networks, and so on, railway networks. And this is mostly also not only related on a physical vulnerability, but also on a functionality loss and functionality assessment of these elements. So a system, you can assess it at the level of one component, like a generic building, a hospital, a bridge, a tunnel, but also at the level of a system, like the whole road network, a whole railway network, and so on. And for each of these levels, you have different types of functionality loss indicators, like direct losses that are related to the direct physical damage, indirect losses, economic losses. And at the level of the system, you have more complex indicators related to connectivity, travel time, when you are talking about road networks, for instance, or indirect economic losses, and so on. And also, you have an aspect of the time scale as well, with a different time scale, also accounting for the long-term recovery and how the situation evolves if you account for the restoration of the degraded network, for instance. And this has been mostly applied by University College London on the case of road networks. So using two, let's say, main metrics for at the system levels for the functionality assessment, the percentage of functional bridges evolving with time, and also the time varying connectivity of the whole network. And this was applied to the road network in Luchon Valley, again in the small valley in the Pyrenees mountain range. And here is an example when you apply some earthquake scenarios. You have a distribution of the expected damage state of the example here of two bridges, for instance. And then you can also, by applying some restoration and repair schemes, along the recovery phase, you can check the evolution of the percentage of functional bridges with time after the earthquake event. So this is the time in days, and this is around 1 year after. And also the connectivity restoration of the whole network. Now I will move on. We have mostly discussed about let's say predictive models or modeling assumptions, let's say static data if you want. And now we are also going to explore what type of sources of observations we have considered as well in this part of the project. So first was using what we call a structural health monitoring. So it's like using sensors mounted on structures to follow the evolution of the buildings and to identify automatically potential damages. So this work was done by colleagues from the EU Center and University of Strathclyde. They considered various knowledge levels of the building. If you have any information from a sensor on top of your building, for instance, or if you have information to have a capacity curve of your building, or if you have enough knowledge to do a fully detailed numerical model of your building. And depending on this, you can apply various techniques to identify dynamic properties, like a frequency domain decomposition, wavelet transformation, and Stokes-Stockwell transformation. And then you have also then three approaches then to identify the damage, which is called empirical approach, analytical approach, and numerical approach. And these three approaches were tested on the results of a shake table campaign that was carried out a few years ago already, where they applied nine sequences of shaking to a building here. And the study here that was done in Turkey was to check these different methods and how accurate they were to estimate the actual damage based on the recorded signals and how close they match the actual damage states. It was found that I think the most accurate way was to use the wavelet transformation approach with white noise, but that also most of the methods also were good to have an approximate, let's say, to the results were not making a mistake more than one damage state away from the target damage state. So if you had a one damage state of of tolerance, if you want, most methods were accurate. And this now are also, these methods have been tested to actual buildings in the Bucharest testbed. And they collected data from two events with magnitude around 4.5, but they were quite away, like 200 kilometers away. And unfortunately, low signal to noise ratios were obtained with the accelerometric channels of the Raspberry shake sensors. And this prevented maybe to use clearly the developed structural health monitoring routines that were shown earlier. But maybe it was concluded that the minimum magnitude to get an acceptable signal to noise ratios in this area was around 5. But also that below 5, it was not expected to have any damage on the buildings. So also, maybe in this context, you do not need to involve actual HHM algorithms for these situations. And also now we're moving to a different, totally different source of observation is the work carried out at EMSC. The use of crowdsourcing or crowdtasking frameworks for the real-time aggregation of in-situ citizen observations. So this was done by developing two online tools. One is called Watts Quakers, so it's a use of a WhatsApp group of experts, of volunteers that are mobilized when, let's say, a damaging earthquake occurs, and they quickly gather the most information possible. And the second one is Last Quakers. So it's a website that is, let's say, emanating from the Last Quaker community. And it also, if anyone can, let's say, connect, give, or collect information on this rapidly, also after an earthquake or even before to get up to date to what is going on. And also another source of observation relying on citizen data is a work done by at the University of Bergamo, was the real-time estimation of the location of people after an earthquake. So it was based on the assumption that people exhibit cyclical spatial temporal pattern during their daily activity during the week, if they are at home, at work, and so on. And using the earthquake network app, where people actually give their location, this information can be actually collected by the smartphone app then, and you can exploit, let's say, and fit for one individual, fit a statistical model of location at a given time, and then use it to have a probability that the person will be at this location after the earthquake. For instance, this is a pattern of a location of a given person for using the app information. And also this information can be expanded at the level of a whole city population if you have enough, let's say, users of the app in the city, for instance. You can have extrapolate it, and then you can have the whole, let's say, dynamic population exposure in the case of an earthquake, and then you can have, let's say, the number of people that are exposed to a given shaking level for a given earthquake scenarios. Now I will move on to rapid damage loss assessment. So using all the information that we have seen before, we can also need to integrate scenario tools for damage loss assessment, and mostly for built areas, for common buildings. So two tools were tested. So the Armageddon tool that was developed at BRGM. So it's mostly relying on the semi-empirical macro seismic method using vulnerability indices. And also the Selena tool that uses a wide range of methods from a capacity spectrum method, M2 method, or predefined fragility models. And then these tools can combine the, what we call live data. For instance, the shake map that I've shown before. This will be the estimated ground motion field from the earthquake that just happened. And the cold data is the static data, is the exposure and vulnerability data. And from this, you can carry near real-time projections of damage and loss. For instance, here is an example of the test of the two tools, Armageddon and Selena, on the Pyrenees area, in the Bannière de Luchon area. Here is a comparison of the global damage distribution of the buildings using the EMS 98 damage grades. So the results also were quite satisfying and quite in agreement using two completely different methods. One using semi-empirical methods, and the other one using predefined fragility models. Also, a lot of sensitivity tests have been done on this on these tools. The knowledge-based framework that you have seen at the very beginning of the presentations was also testing different also levels of knowledge and different methods to assess vulnerability classes. And here you have the comparison again in the Luchon Valley, the Pyrenees, of the results of the scenarios, and for the five damage grades and the variations in the damage distributions using different taxonomy schemes. Here is the comparison between Selena and Armageddon that I've shown before. And also, tests were done also again in the Pyrenees on the effect of the resolution of the site amplification maps that are very important for the damage assessment, and also the resolution of your exposure data set. And here, on four municipalities, you have the colors represents the damage rate distribution, and the last column represents the damage distribution if you use exposure data set at the level of the municipality. And the columns before represents the damage distribution at a various city districts, so smaller scale, at the different city districts, and so that you can see the difference of resolution if you have only data at the level of the municipality or at the level of a city block or a city neighborhood, for instance. And similar tests also have been done in Iceland on this, using also different sets of exposure data sets and comparing the damage distributions that results from these variations in data input. And finally, we move on to the Bayesian updating method for damage and loss estimates. So first at the level of a structure, and then at the level of a whole area affected by the earthquake. So this work was done in, also in collaboration with the University of Strathclyde. So we developed a Bayesian network. So how does it work? It's a Bayesian network is a combination of probabilistic variables that are conditional on one another. For instance, if your damage grade depends on the level of seismic intensity, and your level of seismic intensity depends on the magnitude and the distance, and so on. So all these variables are represented, if you want, in these networks with the arrows that shows the dependency from one another. So here, this whole part here is about the definition of the seismic shaking, given magnitude and location of the earthquake. And here you have the seismic response that can be indicated by three indicators. So here you have the transient drift, the residual drift, and the peak accelerations. So these were the three physical metrics or three parameters that were used to characterize the response of the structure, in this case a bridge. And from this, so you can assess the seismic damage and the seismic loss. And we have access, so we can then postulate that if we put sensors on top of the bridge or on the bottom of the bridge, on the bottom of the bridge, you can measure directly, for instance, the acceleration at the site. But if you have maybe nearby also seismic stations, you can also maybe constrain the ground motion field that is likely to happen here, like using like the shake map that I've shown before. And also, if you can use a Raspberry shake sensor, you can measure on the top of the bridge, you can measure the transient drift. The peak acceleration, for instance. And if you also have a GNSS receiver on the top of the bridge, you can also measure the residual displacement or residual drift after the earthquake. And all these data then can be entered as evidence in the Bayesian network, and you can update everything and better constrain your expected probability of damage of your bridge. So you apply this to the Patras area using an arbitrary virtual bridge and some stations and using two earthquake scenarios here. And then you can compute the gain for the value of information that is brought by various setups. If you have only seismic stations, if you have a seismic station at the bottom of the bridge, at the top, and so on. And this can give you, let's say, the benefit of given instrumentation schemes, if you want, yeah. In terms of then the accuracy of damage estimates. And then we apply this whole Bayesian network thing also to a whole network now. So computing the connectivity road network. Let's say computing the damage states of a set of bridges, and also at the level of a built area. So this was tested again in the Pyrenees Valley using a large system of more than 100 bridges that were connected, connecting 53 municipalities or built areas. And then again, the observations can be if you observe the damage of a bridge, or if you record the PGA intensity at a given location with seismic stations. And these types of observations can then update the whole other variables like the system connectivity of the road network. So here is the case study area. You can see the various polygons that represents the 50 municipalities. We applied given earthquake scenarios in the area. The earthquake epicenter was around here. And you have various seismic stations located on bridges or next to them. And then, for instance, this is the prior estimate. So this would be, for instance, the result if you just apply the whole predictive model using just the earthquake parameters, and you get a predictive map of a damage rate of the various municipalities here. The colors indicate the severity of the damage distribution. And this is, let's say, if you use all the information that you can record from the field, then you update your damage distribution. So this is the posterior estimate. And also you can update the uncertainty also on the expected intensity measures on the various sites, thanks to the location of all the observation sources. And also, applied to a road network and to bridges, you can also here, for instance, you can again, you have a prior estimate of the probability of failure of the various bridges that are the circles here. And from this, you can have maybe a preferred route if you want maybe to evacuate REIA and go up to the north. So if you want to travel from A to B, the black line here, the bold line, represents the route with the safest or the most chance that it remains accessible given the probability of failure of the bridges that you encounter along the way. And again, this is the posterior estimate using the observations. You have you update the probability of failure of your bridges, but also most importantly, then as a consequence, the system will propose you a different route between routes between A and B, because then also the accessibility probability of the different routes will change based on the observations. Here's an example of between the prior estimate and then using the observations, that in the situation can change a lot. Okay, so I'm finishing here. So we have seen that field observations are essential to get an accurate picture of the situation right after the event. We propose to, let's say, use various types of observations from sensors in free field, like a Raspberry Shake 4D, that may be used to compute better shake maps, or also sensors on structures, Raspberry Shake combined with GNSS receivers, for instance, for the damage identification of structures, and also the use of social media and citizen data to also better constrain this aspect. And to do this, we have developed algorithms that can merge observations with predictive models. And this can give access to a progressive refinement of damage and loss estimates. And finally, we also can apply this updating approach to infrastructure systems, because these types of systems, like road networks, are important to have an overview of the systemic effects or cascading effects during the crisis and the recovery process. Yeah. Okay. Thanks a lot, yeah.